Hi, welcome. This is Clemens at Elektor. In this video, I will show you how to reconstruct an infrared remote control when the original one has gone missing or died. Last week, I went to the garbage disposal to get rid of some garbage. And when done, I saw this TV standing against a bin. Now, when it's standing against the bin instead of being inside it, it usually means that the original owners don't want it anymore, but that the device itself is probably still working. So I took it with me and I smuggled it into our home. When I connected the TV to the mains power supply, the standby LED turned red and pressing the power button it even became green. Pressing one of the menu buttons here brings up a menu and you can also select the source. When I connected the TV to the roof antenna, I even got a perfect image. It seemed that I had recovered a fully functional TV. The only thing missing was a remote control, which is a pity. You can access most of the TV's functions by pressing the push buttons on it, but this is not very practical. A remote control would be much handier. The TV is an Oceanic OCLED 32HD5, also known as a GDL32AC528Q, which, according to the internet, is also a Continental Edison TV. I even downloaded the manual to prove this. I have this universal remote control that I once bought to replace all our remote controls by a single unit to control everything, but that project had never gone any further than the idea stage. Luckily, I had kept the user manual, and looking through it, I discovered that it had 17 possibilities for Oceanic TVs and 9 more for Continental Edison TVs. Unfortunately, none of them worked. However, the universal remote control can also cycle through all the codes it knows of, and all you have to do then is watch the TV and see if something happens while the remote is sending the different codes. When something happens, you can read the code on the remote's display. Doing this, I got lucky at code 280 when the TV suddenly showed its volume minus menu. Looking through the user manual, I discovered that this code belongs to an Hitachi TV. So now I had some of the RC codes, but not all. The number keys were working fine, and I had volume down and mute, but not on the right keys. And missing were, for instance, standby, or channel up and down, or volume up. So how to get these missing codes? Several years ago, I had played with Arduino and infrared remote controls, and I had written a few sketches or programs to experiment with sending and receiving RC codes. One of the sketches I wrote tries to guess the protocol used by looking at the beginning of a code. To make this sketch work, all that you have to do is connect an IR receiver IC, like this TSUB1738, to one of the Arduino extension connectors. Such an IC only has 3 pins, 2 of which are power supply pins, leaving only 1 pin for data. You can stick those ICs directly in the extension connector of an Arduino Uno compatible board. When running the sketch to guess the protocol and pointing the remote at it, it gave me NEC. Now this is not surprising, as at the time when I wrote that sketch, about 90% of the remotes I tried used that protocol. This protocol is also known as NEC1. This is the NEC1 data format. An RC code starts with a pulse of about 9 milliseconds, followed by a pause, meaning no signal, of 4.5 milliseconds. Then there are 32 data bits. Data bits are separated from each other by short pulses of about 560 microseconds. The value of a bit is encoded in the pause that follows it. For a 0, this is a pause of 560 microseconds, and for a 1, the pause is about 1.7 milliseconds. After the data bits comes a stop signal, which is a pause of at least 5 milliseconds. Because at the time I had so many NEC-type remotes, I had also written a sketch to decode the protocol. Running this sketch and firing RC codes at it immediately gave results. It turned out that the TV responded to codes that started with 02FD in hexadecimal. The data is encoded in the next byte or 8 bits as a value from 0 to 255. Then comes a kind of checksum byte, which is the 1's complement of the data byte. This means that it has the same value, except that the zeros have been replaced by 1's and the 1's have been replaced by zeros. This kind of checksum not only offers a simple means of detecting obvious transmission errors, it also ensures that every code has the same number of 1's and zeros. In this case, every code contains 16 zeros and 16 1's. Every code therefore has the same length in time. Every code also has the same average value or DC level, and every code will consume the same amount of energy. At first sight, this protocol seems to be rather simple with only 256 possible key codes, but there may be more to it. If you look closely at the beginning, the 0-2-FD part, then you will notice that 0 and F are complements of each other, and the same is true for 2 and D. This may be something to keep in mind if we can't find all the codes the easy way, meaning by simply sending the 256 possible codes to the TV. Not very important, but good to know, is that the least significant bit is transited first, so you have to read the bits from right to left. Sending IR codes with an Arduino is as easy as receiving them. Just connect an infrared LED in series with a current limiting resistor to a pin that can be a digital output, which is any pin on an Arduino. I used the pin 2, which is the first pin after the serial port that I reserved for communication with a computer. During my experiments with infrared remote controls, I had also written a sketch to send NEC type codes. All I had to do now was modify it a bit so that it would be practical for finding codes. For this, I used a serial terminal. Sending a space to the Arduino makes it send a code, and then it lets you write a comment in the serial terminal. This is practical for keeping track of what a code does. Pressing enter in the serial terminal signals the end of a comment and advances the code to the next code. When you press space again, it will send the next code. Now, sometimes a code opens a menu on a TV and you have to send the same code again to close it. For this, I implemented the R command, so when you press the R key, it will resend the code that you just sent. With plus and minus key commands, you can increment or decrement the RC code, which gives you some more control. With this sketch, I quickly found most of the codes. Power on and off, for instance, is number 11, and number 49 is subtitles on and off. This way, I also discovered that this TV has personal video recording on a USB stick capabilities, PVR, and that it can function as some kind of a multimedia server. I did not find arrow and OK and exit keys, as that requires to first open a menu and then search for codes. I stopped here as I now had enough data to program a universal remote control with the codes that I had found. For this I used another universal remote control that I had lying around, a simple one with only a power button, channel up and down buttons, volume up and down button and a mute button. After putting it in learning mode, I could fire the corresponding codes with the same Arduino sketch that I had used for discovering them. The R command turned out to be very practical for this. Now I have a usable remote control for my new old TV. Okay, here ends this video. In this video I showed you how I reconstructed an infrared remote control for a TV that I had found in the garbage dump using only simple Arduino setups. I also showed you how the popular NEC1 protocol works that is used by so many of these devices. You can find the link to download the sketches I used in this video in the description below. Okay, that's it. I hope you found it interesting. Please don't forget to subscribe to our channel and tap or click the bell button. Thank you for watching.